And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, let's give God a hand of praise. He's worthy to be praised. We're so thankful. You may be seated and so honored to be in the house of the Lord this morning to give him the praise, the glory, and the honor, and to thank him for all the blessings that he has blessed us with. We do thank God for all our friends and all our visitors that visit the Pentecostal Revival Hour. That watch on Saturday and Sundays. And we just thank God for all the people that donate to the ministry to help us to keep it going, all the carts, all the ladders, birthday cards, and everything. We just give God the praise and the glory and the honor. And we are so thankful for all that the Lord is doing in the ministry to keep it going. It takes a lot of work, a lot of dedication, a lot of faithfulness to stay with the Lord. There's a lot of things that we have to do to keep everything going. And I just want to give God the praise, the glory, and the honor for everything that he is doing. Because when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he done for us, my soul is still crying out, hallelujah. I thank God for what he has done for us. Because truly we can say that he is good to us all the time. No matter what we have to go through, no matter what come up on us, God is still good. I give him the praise, the glory, and the honor for staying with us, and we stand with him. Because as that Sunday school said this morning, we are complete in him. He's the one that make us complete. He's the one that lead us, that guide us, and that bring all things to our remembrance. And we just give him the praise, the glory, and the honor. And we thank him for all of these blessings that he just keep on keeping, keep on keeping us going. I know a lot of people ask me, how do we do it? And I tell people all of the time, it's not us. It's the Lord. People, it's the Lord that keep us going. Because without the Lord, we couldn't do anything. And I'm so thankful for a ministry that I can be in where there is no big eyes and no little U's. But everybody is somebody in the Lord. And I thank God for having that kind of love, you know. A lot of time people get in certain positions, they change. But it ain't no time to change. It's time for us to be on one accord. It's time for us to have the same mind. Because God is a God that he can bless all of us. All of us at the same time. He got enough blessing for everybody. And I thank God we had a wonderful week last week. And I thank God. And oh, I'm just looking forward to starting tomorrow night. We are going to be in our first revival of the year. And I just thank God, praise God for the revival. Praise God, the Pasai revival. And I thank God, praise God for it. Praise God. God is so awesome and so good to us. So I'm not going to be long the time. We're going to turn the devotional service over into the system, Pastor Walton, And as he come, let's give God a hand of praise. Glad to see him coming.
Praise the Lord, saints. Yes, he's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. This time we ask everyone to stand. Let us all bow our head and let's repeat the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. The song said, I can only imagine what it's going to be like when I get on the other side. Praise the Lord. I can only imagine. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. I can only imagine what it would be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine it. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knee will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine. When all I'll do is forever, forever worship you, I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all you be still, will I stand in your presence? Or to my knee will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knee will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I'll do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. Oh, yes, we can only imagine what it's going to be like when we reach the other side.
Amen, amen. Look what the Lord has done. And at this time, I'm going to ask everyone to get your Bibles. Hold them up and repeat after me. This is my Bible. I am what it says that I am. I believe what it says to believe. I come to the Lizella Pentecostal Church to be taught the Word of God. I will not serve the devil. I will not live in sin. Jesus Christ died for my sins, and the blood of Jesus cleanses me from all sin. I am Christ-like. I am born again. I have power over the devil. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen once again. Let's give the Lord another hand of praise. And if you will, just bow your heads right where you are. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you glory, honor, praise, and worship. We thank you for yet another opportunity to come before you and also before your people. And Lord, we pray as we go forth into your word this morning that it is mainly a word of salvation to the lost, a word of healing to those who are sick and who are afflicted, a word of deliverance to those who are bound, and also a word of knowledge that we all may appreciate you more and learn more of you. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us all say amen. 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 Once again, you may be seated. Again, we thank God for his grace and mercy being extended unto us all. Because where would we be if we didn't have the Lord on our side? I also want to thank God for his son, Jesus, coming into this world to save us from our sin, to deliver us out of the hand of the enemy. I also want to thank God for the precious gift of the Holy Ghost that has been made available unto us. Again, that is what gives us power over all the power of the enemy. That is what destroys yokes in our lives. Again, it is given to all who are willing to obey the voice of the Lord. I also want to thank God for the natural people who he placed. Thank God for the founder of this ministry, Apostle Albert Phelps. We are continuing on in his legacy. I also want to thank God for our current president, Senior Pastor Phelps. Thank God for her being in the service this morning. Thank God for her continuing to allow God to use her to lead us in this ministry. I also want to thank God for all the other pastors being in the house. Thank God for Pastor Wooten being here this morning. We're continuing to pray for Pastor Dennert. Thank God for all the assistant pastors, all the other ministers of the gospel, all the deacons, all the other saints, friends, visitors. We also thank God for those of you who are watching the live stream and also those who will be watching by television. We're going to go on and get into it. I'm continuing to preach and teach from a book that many people are afraid of. We don't hear much reading or messages being preached or even teachings on this book. Most people have not even read this book. And the book that I'm talking about, I'm going to tell you what it's not. It's not the book of Revelation. That's what most people are afraid of. But there's another book that I think is more fearful, especially among us believers, than the book of Revelation. And that book is the Song of Solomon. Rarely, as I said, do you hear preachings, teachings. Rarely do you even hear someone quote from the Song of Solomon. But I believe this is a very important book. Because as I told you and showed you last week, that all scripture, well, 2 weeks ago, all scripture, and that includes everything in this book, is inspired by God. If it were not so with this book, it would not have been placed in here. But there is a reason for the Song of Solomon. God desires everyone to have success in their relationships. Male and female, he created them for each other. And a lot of people want to discredit Solomon because of him having so many dealings with so many different women, which he did. Had over 700 wives, 300 concubines. And so many people say, well, Solomon, you had too many women. But I look at it like this. Who can tell you more about the struggles of alcohol better than an alcoholic? Who can tell you more about the struggles of drug addiction than the one who has been a drug addict? So in the book of Song of Solomon, there has to have been one relationship that he had that was successful. And the manner in which these two became one or came together is recorded. We have information coming from the female as well as the male in displaying their feelings toward one another. As I said last time, if the book of Song of Solomon was a dirty book, we wouldn't have it. That's right. But again, all scripture is given for our learning so that we will be perfect in the will of God. God desires every male and female that are in a relationship for it to be successful. That it for it to last, for it to endure. And so we see here in the book of Song, in the Song of Solomon, how this relationship is beginning. And as I said, they are displaying affection one towards another. It was brought to my attention that the reading that I read last time was a little bit different than what many of you have. So I'm going to correct that today. I'm going to be reading from our traditional King James Version as well as from where I have received my information from. I do want to cite my source, as I am not a plagiarist, but much of the information that I will be relaying to you is from relevant Bible teaching. And if any one of you want to follow me on that, there's a website called Relevant Bible Teaching, and this is where I'm going to be getting much of what I share with you. As I told you last time, this is a subject that I'm not an expert on. So the Bible tells us to mark the perfect man. Find someone who better and is more knowledgeable of a subject or area, and listen to their teachings and their readings and apply what you learn in your life. Most of us, as far as relationships is concerned, we wrap it all up into sex. There is love, romance, intimacy, and sex. Most people think sex is all of that, but that's not so. You can have love without having sex. You can have romance without having sex. You can have intimacy without having sex. But we have been misinformed. And as I stated last time, I can't fault our foreparents. But all I can fault is ignorance. People just don't know better. And as a result of us not knowing better, many relationships fail. Many relationships fall apart. Some people are living in relationship, but they're not happy. But because of our failure to understand all of these components, again, you have love, romance, intimacy, and sex. All of that is going to make up the union of marriage. Okay? I began to think about that word intimacy. Intimacy is when you are willing to share things that you may not even like about yourself with the other person that you are involved with. As we go through this reading, we're going to see where sometimes the young Shulamite lady, she shares some things about herself that she is uncomfortable with, that she feels that would make her inferior to Solomon. Don't forget the position of Solomon. He was way up there, high in society. Whereas this little Shulamite woman was just a common worker. She was a common person. She was not a queen. She was not what you may call a princess. But she worked. And I think that's kind of where we left off at last time with that fifth verse. I'm going to reread that. It says, I am black but comely, O ye daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar, as the curtains of Solomon. Look not upon me because I am black, because the sun hath looked upon me. My mother's children were angry with me. They made me keeper of the vineyard, but mine own vineyard have I not kept. So again, we see the insecurity that this female has because of her skin complexion. She is darker than many of the other women that Solomon had a chance to accept as his wife. But she begins to say, even in her insecurity, she begins to tell him that, hey, don't look upon me because I'm black or dark complexion. Then she tells why. Because the sun. I've been out in the sun. My brothers had me out in the vineyard working. This is the reason why her complexion was the way that it was. I'm going down into verse 7. It says, tell me, O thou, whom my soul loveth, where thou feedest, where thou makest thy flock to rest at noon. For why should I be as one that turneth aside by the flocks of the companions? And so again, she's going on to say how, and continuing to express herself. And I do want to share this reading on that verse that I have. And it reads, yet evidently reassured of herself, she expresses to Solomon that she wants to see him more. In other words, she makes it clear that she would like him to continue pursuing her. She doesn't lead him on, nor is she intentionally vague about her feelings toward him. It is evident that she wants to go forward in the relationship, telling him that she loves him at a deep soul level. Obviously, the outward physical attraction is there, but she also appreciates his character, personality, and heart. There is nothing of a casual relationship here, but one of true love where marriage is believed to be the likely outcome by both parties. She wants to know where he goes during the day with his flock, and she wishes to be invited to visit him. She doesn't want to play the seductress and prostitute as many other women do to some of Solomon's friends while they are out with the sheep. She wants true romance, not manipulation by appealing to carnal appetites. So again, this is a person who desires a true relationship, and at this point, it is non-sexual. But she desires to develop a relationship with Solomon. She asks him about, where do you take your flocks? Because she wants to come visit him sometime. Again, she wants to get to know him. Not just for sexual activities, but for the form a long-lasting relationship. Again, leading to marriage. Again, where do you make the flocks lie down at noon? For why should I be like one who veils herself beside the flocks of your companions? Because Solomon had some brothers, fellow shepherds, who would go out and they would hook up with women. But she letting Solomon know, I don't want to be like, I don't want to have a relationship like that. I don't want to have a hookup. I wanted to be more than that. And this is what she's portraying in her feelings toward him. Another thing that I meant to bring out, it just hit me, that many of us, our source for information as we were growing, we received bad information. As I brought out earlier about our parents were ignorant, may have been, ignorant, just didn't know. Also, many of us resorted to the streets. You're definitely going to get wrong information dealing with people who are out running the streets. They're going to give you bad information. Many of us resorted to television, what we thought a relationship would be based upon what we have seen on television. Some of us resorted to pornography. That's what we thought love was all about. Was sex. But all of that is wrong. It's bad information. If you want to know something about having a good relationship with somebody, you need to resort to the Word of God. That is the best source. You need to come to this book, this Song of Solomon book that I'm reading from and teaching from today. This is going to teach you how to talk to one another. Those of you who are in committed relationships, this is how you ought to be communicating with one another. Tell the person that you are involved with how much you love them and what you love about them. This is what she's doing. All right, so now I'm going to get on back. Get off that little soapbox. Verse 7 reads, "Tell me, O thou, whom my soul loveth, where thou feedest, where thou makest the flock to rest at noon. For why should I be as one that turneth aside by the flocks of thy companions? If thou know not, O thou fairest among women, go thy way forth by the footsteps of the flock, and feed my kids beside the shepherd tents." Okay, so now he begins to answer her in the 8th verse. Says he responds by inviting her to come and visit him while he is working. He probably thought she already knew where he shepherded his flock, and perhaps even wondered why she didn't come and visit if she adored him so much. He tells her where to go so she can take her own goats and visit the tents of the shepherds. He has responded to her interest by taking a step forward in furthering the relationship as they spend more time together. He makes it clear to her as well how he feels very early in this relationship. He thinks that she is the most beautiful among women. They are very open about what they think of one another early on in the relationship. Again, they are not playing games, but they are simply deeply attracted to one another, pursuing one another with the understanding that things could end up in marriage. Again, marriage is the end goal. That should be the end goal of everyone who is looking forward. These young people, as you were beginning to develop relationship with people of the opposite sex, the end goal should not be the bedroom. The end goal should be marriage. But you need to spend time with one another. Get to know one another. This is what these two people are doing. They're spending time with one another. She wants to know where he is, where she can come and visit him. He tells her where he is. They're not lying to one another. They are mutually interested in one another. Let's go on verse 9. It says, "I have compared thee, O my love, to a company of horses in Pharaoh's chariots. Thy cheeks are comely with rows of jewels, thy neck with chains of gold. We will make the borders of gold with studs of silver." So now, here Solomon is again comparing her to the horses of Pharaoh's chariots. You know, those are top quality horses. All horses are not the same. All people are not the same. Some people are better than others. Listen to this reading. It says, here we get further insight into why Solomon is so caught up with this woman. Certainly her character matters, but Solomon is drawn to her outward appearance, which he compliments. He doesn't say too much too fast, but he calls her his darling, companion, a word indicative of a relationship headed toward marriage, and compares her to a mare among chariots. Getting back to those horses. Now, Pharaoh's chariots had to be exquisitely decorated and beautiful. Solomon's horse had to be the best in the kingdom. Though this isn't an analogy that we would use today in our culture, Solomon's point was clear. Even among the beautiful, she was the most beautiful. He compliments her cheeks, something we wouldn't do today either. But it is a high compliment to her without getting too risque in complimenting her about features he shouldn't be focusing on yet. That is not to say that he wouldn't have noticed her beautiful features, but they are not his focus as he is trying to get to know her heart. He continues to tell her, in effect, that she has a beautiful face and that her jewelry looks good on her. Certainly, jewelry is not a forbidden thing in the Bible. I know some people teach that it is. If you look at Ezekiel 16, 11 and 12, you will see that jewelry is not forbidden. But a preoccupation with it is wrong as using it to define beauty at the expense of the inner person. 1 Peter 3:3-5. And in that, you see that your features should not be based upon your jewelry. Your jewelry should be used to accent your features. Okay? She is wearing a lovely piece, lovely necklace, which he notices. It is not extravagant, being merely of string of beads. He pledges to make for her something even better, jewelry of gold and silver. Solomon knows that women appreciate these kind of gifts. All right, men. Solomon knows that women appreciate these kind of gifts as it reminds them that they are loved and special, worth the expense of silver and gold. Men should learn from Solomon that we need to speak kind words complimenting the appearance of our beloved. We need to learn to do that. We need to learn not just when we're trying to get them. Many men have those kind words when they are trying to get them. But as the relationship matures, those kind words should continue even more. Okay? It's just like this. Some men, they compliment their significant other until they get them. After they get them, the compliments wear down. But you know what old joker out there gonna do? Old joker out there is gonna come with some compliments. And if your significant other is not getting those compliments at home, and old Joe keep come telling her how good she looks, after why, old Joe out there gonna start getting her attention. So, but we don't want that to happen. If we compliment them, tell them how beautiful they are before we marry them or get with them, then we ought to continue those compliments after. See, this is what needs to be taught in the church. This is a part of holiness. This is a part of righteousness. This is a part of love. Okay? And as I said, many have failed in that area. But as we learn to do better, do better. All right, let's go on down. Verse 12 reads, while the king sitteth at his table, my spikenard sendeth forth the smell thereof. A bundle of myrrh is my well-beloved unto me. He shall lie all night betwixt my breasts. I hear y'all. I hear y'all. My beloved is unto me as a cluster of campfire in the vineyards of En-Gedi. All right. So now, again, this is not dirty. This is not dirty. Again, during a meal at the king's table, the young woman was aware that her perfume's fragrance was spreading throughout the room. This was her intention, as men too appreciate pleasant fragrances. Her beloved is so important to her that he is like precious myrrh and beautiful henna blossoms. He is a prized possession whom she wants to be with forever. So now here, while she is at the king's table, she's smelling good. So you women are tighten up on your perfume game. Men like that too. I know some of y'all women, a good looking, good smelling man walk by you, you turn your head all the way around. What's that smell? Men the same way. Good smelling woman walk past you, you want to figure out what it is. But this is what will happen. There's nothing wrong with that. We all don't want to smell good. Everybody like the smell good. And my mama used to call it put some smell good on. I still have a bottle of my dad's cologne. He liked that polo blue. I still have a bottle of it. I don't wear it because it's in memory of him. This was his favorite, and he gave me a bottle, and I still had it. But it was something that I think senior pastor liked. Possible come around and make sure you clean up first now. Don't put cologne and perfume on top of funk. Clean up, take a bath first. Then put your smell good on. Because you know, something God said was stinking in his nostrils. And when someone was sending up good with bad, that stinks in God's nostril. And when someone mixing good smelling cologne with funk, that's going to stink in your nostrils. So this is what she was doing. She was smelling good. She went in the king's house smelling good. And then it goes on down into verse 15. It reads, "Behold, thou art fair, my love. Behold, thou art fair. Thou hast dove's eyes. Behold, thou art fair, my beloved. Yea, pleasant also our bed is green. The beams of our house are cedar, and our rafters of fir." So now we see that the romance continues on, and Solomon can't get over how beautiful this woman is. He says it twice, referring again to her as his darling. He is enraptured with her beauty, both inward and outward, but certainly outward. He doesn't over-spiritualize things, but he is simply drawn to this wonderful creation and gift of God. He realizes what she is, that she is a gift of God. Every one of you who are in serious relationships, you have to realize that your significant other is your gift that God gave you. Again, this is his perfect complement. The exclamation points as he speaks of her beauty are not accidental. He can't contain himself, for she is so beautiful. He compliments her eyes. Again, not something too sexual at this point, but something women really appreciate, because it shows that the man takes notice of the little things in like what he sees. Nothing escapes the notice of Solomon. He notices fragrances that she wears, jewelry that she has chooses. And her delicate features, such as cheeks and eyes. It is evident to the young woman that he takes careful note of how she looks and how she adorns herself, because he adores her. She responds to his enthusiasm for her beauty by calling him handsome, an analogous term for beautiful. And her beloved. These are not casual daters, but those who are connected at the deepest level, both hoping that it will end in marriage. This man, she says, is pleasant to be around. He doesn't annoy her or take her for granted. He makes her feel as if she is the most precious and prized possession in all of the kingdom. Their relationship is anchored, strong, and is utterly wonderful and luxuriant. They are living in luxury, savoring one another, both being confident in the other's words and motives. So now we see again the motive for both of these eventually is to wind up being together in marriage. But in the meantime, they have to get to know one another in a non-sexual way. As I said earlier, sex is not the purpose, main purpose or focus of either one of these individuals. And there's nothing wrong with complimenting someone. If they're doing something good, doing something right, we need to compliment them. Even our children. If our children are doing something good, We need to let them know that, hey, we appreciate what they're doing. Because we want that behavior, that same good thing that they're doing, to keep going, for them to keep doing good. But if all they hear out of our mouth is you aren't anything, and I'm going to say it the way we say it, you ain't nothing, you dumb, you stupid, you ignorant, then that behavior will keep on carrying on. We have to learn to speak life. Even if they do something bad, instead of telling them how bad they were, tell them, nah, you better than that. You can do, but you better than that. I know you better than that. You don't have to keep making that bad decision. You can do better. But this is the way, again, in the relationship, it's the same way. If a man begins to dog a woman out and continues to dog her out and continues to dog her out, then on down the line, if that woman has sense, she's going to get tired of that. She's going to want to cut that off. She's going to want to get out of that relationship. It's like an old scary dog. You see a dog that always walking around with their tail between the legs and they scared of everything. It's because that dog has been abused. You go to step toward the dog, and the dog looking at you and sticking the tail between the legs. That even a dog has been abused, and you can tell that. People the same way. But we don't want to abuse one another in our relationships. Our relationship, as the years go by, it should get better and better and better. The compliments ought to keep on coming. And so I hope I'm helping us. Again, going through looking at this, and this is just the first chapter. In the future, we're going to continue on in the study of this book. And I want, even if our relationships, us older people, didn't work out, we want the next generation. We want our children, our grandchildren, to learn and know to do better in their relationships than we may have even done in ours. I share with my kids my failures, my regrets, things that I didn't do right. And whenever they do something that I don't think is right, I have to reflect back on myself. How was I when I was their age? And when I think about it, I can't be so hard on them because I was worse than they are. So again, we just have to learn. Life is a continual learning process. We learn from our mistakes. And we also learn from the mistakes of others. And as I said, I want our kids, whenever they get into their relationship, I want their relationship to be better. I want them to know what a relationship is about. Relationship is not all about sex. There's more to it than that.
We hope you have enjoyed our program today. We want to invite you to view all of our telecasts. We're on Christian Television Network on Sundays at 3 p.m. Eastern Time. We're also on station WGNM, Cox Cable Channel 7, on Saturdays at 5 p.m. and Sundays at 3 p.m. On our programs, we have closed caption available. Our services can also be seen on the Lizella Pentecostal Church Facebook and on YouTube. Come and be with us in our services. We're in three locations: Forsyth, Lizella, and Fort Valley, Georgia. We begin with Sunday school at 9 a.m., followed by morning worship at 11 a.m. We have Bible studies on Mondays and Tuesdays at 7 p.m. Join us for Sunday school and Bible study on Zoom. Our meeting ID number is 296-151-7611. And our passcode is 399-261. So again, thank you for joining us today. And we look forward to seeing you again in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. I can only imagine what it would be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine it. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knee will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine. When all I'll do is forever, forever worship you.